सर प्लीज।
हेलो, गुड मॉर्निंग एवरीबॉडी।
गुड मॉर्निंग सर।
गुड मॉर्निंग सर।
गुड मॉर्निंग एवरीबॉडी। आई वेलकम ऑल द पार्टिसिपेंट्स इन द 20th सेक्शन ऑफ वेबिनार सीरीज 2020 कंडक्टेड बाय इंडियन क्रिमिनोलॉजी एंड फॉरेंसिक साइंस एसोसिएशन एंड कोलैबोरेटिंग इंस्टीट्यूशन। फर्स्ट एंड फॉरमोस्ट I express my sincere gratitude to the ICFSA for giving me an opportunity to be the presiding expert in this session. I am Dr. Shaji Praha, Assistant Chemical Examiner in Chemical Examiners Laboratory, Tiruvananthapuram. Chemical Examiners Laboratory is one of the pioneer forensic lab in India, established in 1890. The headquarters of the laboratory is at the state capital Tiruvananthapuram, with two regional laboratories at Ernakulam and Kozhikode. Our laboratory is committed to provide services of international standard to assist the criminal justice system through a quality management system based on the guidelines of ISO IEC 17025-20017 standard. The personnel of Chemical Examiners Laboratory Department are work bounded and are acting impartial in their activities. They are also committed to keep confidentiality of their work. Chemical Examiners Laboratory Department is the only department in India whose all laboratories are accredited by NABL under ISO IEC 17025-20017. Department has five major divisions, namely toxicology, serology, narcotics, excise, and general chemistry. In toxicology division, viscera, PM blood, etc. are analyzed with an aim to detect the cause of unnatural death. Other material objects forwarded from honorable court are also analyzed in this division as per the requirement of investigating officers. Body fluids, grouping of blood, detection of spermatozoa in seminal fluids, hair comparison, etc. also done in serology division. Narcotic division analyzes the material objects which comes under the purview of narcotic drugs and psychotropic substance act. Samples includes natural origin, synthetic, and designer category. Articles like spurious liquors and other material objects which are punishable under Abkhari Act are analyzed in excise division. Moreover, samples from licensed shop, distillery, and the blending unit, injects, and other medical preparations are also analyzed. Material objects pertaining to offenses punishable under Essential Commodity Act, Explosive Substance Act, etc. are examined in General Chemistry Division. Exhibits include petroleum products and their residue, concrete, edible oil, metallic exhibits like gold and copper, etc. are analyzed in our laboratory. That is the introduction of our laboratory. Today's speaker is Dr. Abhit Gohale. Is a field application scientist working with the Thermo Fisher Scientific Company for last 9.5 years. For the last 6 years, he is actively supporting the entire human identification workflow at various forensic labs in and around India. Prior to joining the company, he completed his PhD on pathogenesis of central nervous system tumors at Advanced Medical Center for Treatment, Research and Education in Cancer, Navi Mumbai, India. Today, Dr. Amit will be discussing on the topic, maximize your forensic lab efficiency with advances to capillary electrophoresis workflow. Capillary electrophoresis is the primary methodology used for separating and detecting standard repeat alleles in forensic DNA. This is an analytical technique that separates ions based on their electrophoretic mobility with the use of an applied voltage. The electrophoretic mobility depends upon the charge of the molecules, the viscosity, and the radius of. This technique is also used in forensic toxicology, forensic biology, forensic biochemistry, DNA profiling, gunshot residue analysis, and explosives. All the participants are requested to follow the guidelines strictly as prescribed by organizations. Now, I would like to take this opportunity to welcome Dr. Amit to take over the session. Welcome, sir.
First of all, I'd like to thank you all for providing me an opportunity to give a session at your team seminar. So I assume that I'm audible, sir.
Yes, carry on.
Okay. So basically, in this talk, I'll try to cover the following topics. First, why use DNA for criminal justice? Second,
excuse me, Amit. Amit, can you reshare your screen?
Pardon?
Can you reshare your screen? PPT
okay.
Presentation.
Okay. Just 1 minute. Are you able to see my screen, sir?
Yes, Amit, carry on.
So has the slide changed, sir?
Yes, Amit.
Okay. So as I was saying, the agenda of the talk is why use DNA for criminal justice? Second would be what is a DNA profile and how can we create one? Then the next would be what tools do we have to create the DNA profile, like such as DNA extraction, quantification, amplification, that is the whole workflow. So I always like this slide, which is the Locard's exchange principle. So forensic science is guided by Locard's exchange principle. We can say Locard is the father for forensic science. What he says is that every contact leaves a trace. That means when a perpetrator enters the crime scene, he will either take something with him at the crime scene, or he will take away from the site something from the crime scene, and both can be used in forensic applications. So DNA now has been established, as you can say, as a gold standard or as a biometric, because DNA is unique to each individual. So we can identify individuals with high specificity and accuracy. Then because DNA is within our cells and cells can be left behind on the crime scene, chances of detecting them might be greater as compared to some other evidence. Then based on the DNA profile, because those are unique for each individual, even kinship can be established, and across the globe, standardized techniques are being used, and the data, because we are using standardized techniques, the data can be shared across the agency. So for over 3 decades, we have been using DNA to transform global criminal justice. So as a Thermo Fisher company, we are the world's most trusted solution. The best laboratories in the world rely on our FTR kits to accurately genotype human DNA samples every day. So they can be from various countries, the reputed sites like FBI, Ministry of China, then French Ministry, you can say, then German, Europe. So across the globe, most trusted sites are using our kits. So approximately 80% of DNA profiles worldwide have been analyzed using Applied Biosystems SGRT. So we are accepted as the global industry standard for forensic casework samples, establishing convicted offender database, establishing population database, and parentage testing. So first, I will cover in this section how a DNA profile is created or how do we create one. So as we all know, in a human cell, you have the nucleus and the cytoplasm. Within the nucleus is our human genome. That is the blueprint of how our body and all our organs would be generated. So there are around approximately 3 billion base pairs, out of which only 3% are gene related. There are around approximately 25% of repetitive DNA within this region, and of that 25%, approximately 60% are variable number tandem repeats. That means there are some repeat sequences which keep on occurring at regular intervals. So variable number tandem repeats can be further classified down into two parts. One is the mini satellite, where the repeat bases would range from 11 to approximately 11 to 64 bases, and the microsatellites, which are of interest for the forensic community, are within the range of usually 2 to 6 base pairs. So, microsatellite in short stands for STR, or short tandem repeat. So, in this example, microsatellites usually are simple repeated sequences of 2 to 6 base pairs. So, if you see the image on the top, you will see that there is a sequence CTA. So, this is a trinucleotide repeat, and basically, there would be a number of repeats in individual, which will vary from individual to individual. Flanking these two regions are a conserved region. So, that means for each human, those sequences would be common. So, primers are designed within those regions, and the tandem repeats are polymorphic. Like in some individuals, there might be more repeats or less repeats. And this variation in number of repeats is what we use for analysis. The repeats are classified by repeat motif and their molecular complexity. So, how do you designate the name of the allele? Like in a report, you would have seen that for a particular gene, the call would be 6, 7, 6, 10, something like that. So, let us say it's a repeat sequence, like for example, AT, AG, or some repeat. Now, if it occurs 7 times, the allele call number would be 7. If it occurs 8 times, allele call number would be 8. If it repeats 10 times, allele call number would be 10. So, in the example below, you will see that the repeat sequence is AATG. So, it has been repeated 7 times. So, allele call would be 7. In certain scenario, it can happen that instead of having the complete repeat, you might have a partial repeat, as in this case, you have just ATG. So, in this case, the allele you will designate would be 7 plus 3 bases is 7.3. So, if there are only two bases, then the allele call would be 7.2. If there is one base, it would be 7.1. So, also, did you know we use amelogenin as a sex determination marker? But this gene encodes for a protein found in tooth enamel. It is found in both X and Y chromosome, and it has. We use the same pair of primers to amplify both these regions. So, in X chromosome, there is a 6 base pair deletion, therefore its length is shorter. So, if you get a profile in which you have only one single peak in the X region, then it would be a female. Whereas, if you get two peaks, one specific for X, other specific for Y, then that is a male profile. So, how do we generate those STR peaks? So, you use fluorescent dyes, which are labeled to your PCR product, and based on size separation, you generate the PCR product. So, you would have multiple markers as seen in the left hand side of the screen, and then you amplify those. So, for each marker, you have a primer pair in which there is a forward primer and a reverse primer. One of the primers would be labeled with a fluorescent dye, and then the polymorphic regions between people would vary. So, some might have 7 repeats, others might have 8 repeats. So, in an individual, if from maternal side 7 repeats have come, and from paternal side 8 repeats have come, then the allele call would be 7-8 for that particular marker. So, the fluorescent dyes used are different dyes for same size product and same dye for different size product. So, once you have amplified this product, you would run them on CT. So, what you do, you require a size standard. Size standard is something like a scale with which you measure what is the size of your PCR product. So, based on the size standard, the software will generate a standard flow, and then it will calculate what is the length of each amplicon or of the each PCR product. So, you add the size standard, the PCR products in the high dye to denature them, and then you run on the capillary. So, once you run on the capillary, the amplicons or the PCR products will get separated based on their sizes. So, smaller molecules will migrate first and bigger molecules will migrate later. So DNA fragments, once they have performed their migration, they are compared with the help of the size marker, which is loaded within each sample. So once we have generated a profile, how will the software know, or how we will know which allele to call? So what is done that is that in the software itself, each color channel, or that means different fluorescent dyes will have one color channel, are told that there are some specific panels or loci or markers. So there are the fixed marker positions which are already pre-populated within the software for a particular kit. And then within this marker, where the physical locations of the bins or the alleles are present is designated, and all these alleles, common alleles, are purified and sequenced and then clubbed together in an allelic ladder. So allelic ladder forms a sort of a reference, as you can see in this picture. In a normal sample, you will not see this many peaks, but allelic ladder is something which is a reference against which the software will give a call. Like for in this slide, if you see, the top portion is the ladder where all possible alleles in a given population, or the majority of the alleles in a given population, are added together and combined. So all physical locations are located here. Whereas for a particular sample, in this case, like the allele calls are 23 and 25. So software will compare them with the allelic ladder, and automatically it will give you the calls for those specific alleles. So then how does the DNA profile look like? In both the slides, you will see that basically for each marker, there you would get multiple alleles. If there are two peaks within a marker, then that sample allele, that particular marker is heterozygous condition, and or if you get a single allele, then that condition is homozygous. So what tools do we have to create profiles? The first part I have covered is in a very concise manner the process of how we generate the profiles, and then in order to generate profiles, what tools do we have? So in forensics, there is a terminology called first pass success. By first pass success, I mean that when you perform a run, starting from DNA extraction right till generating a profile, if you get the results in a single go, then that is called the first pass success. The more first pass successes you have, the higher your throughput would be, basically, and faster turnaround time. So today's forensic labs face a variety of challenges that are because of more media coverage, more awareness among the general public. You have, like, the labs have started getting increasing sample volume. Then the sample types are also now not standard samples. They can be any type of sample. So though many of the times you get difficult and compromised samples. In case of labs where they are, like in India, right, currently the databasing is still work in progress. But internationally, the database sizes are also increasing.
Yes, Amit, carry on.
Basically with new advances, the quality standards have started increasing. They are becoming more stringent, and then there you have workflow bottlenecks. So as a Thermo Fisher company, we have an unsurpassed and evolving portfolio. We keep on evolving to meet the latest standards, and we have been working and evolving in the field of human identification for over 25 years, right? The whole workflow is right from starting with sample correction to data extraction, in which we offer extraction kits such as Stratfiler kit, along with automated extraction systems such as AutomatExpress and ID Nimbus Presto. Then once you have extracted the DNA, you will quantify it using real-time machines such as 7500 or the latest system such as Quant Studio 5 real-time feature instrument. And also the software also has been recently upgraded to version 1.3, where we have virtual standards of option. I'll talk about that in detail in later. Then to complement that, you have technologies such as Trio kit or HP kit. So once you have quantified the DNA, whether it is having high quantity, low quantity, whether there is inhibition, degradation, or it's a mixture for male, female, then based on that, you decide which kit you will use for your downstream application. Then you would amplify those kits on a thermal cycler such as ProFlex, using either for autosomal markers like Global Filer, Verifiler, or for Y-specific kits, you would use Y-Filer Plus. Once you have amplified this product, you would run them on a capillary electrophoresis, that is a detection and sequencing system, such as 3500 or the latest system, that is Seq Studio. Also, we also offer latest cutting-edge technology, such as Rapid Hit ID, which is a rapid DNA technology, and NGS, that is Precision ID Panels, and the NGS system. To complement the machinery and the process, we also provide the complementary software, such as RapidLink software, which is used with Rapid Technology, Converge, that is used with NGS, and our gold standard workhorse, that is the GeneMapper IDX software, which is used for profiling using capillary electrophoresis. Moreover, we also provide dedicated support, and we have a team of professionals. We offer forensic professional services. We have a dedicated team to cater to your needs. And we follow the world-class ISO 18385 manufacturing practices. That are the best practices that are available. So I'll start first with DNA extraction. So whenever you are working with DNA extraction, so I always like a terminology in software that is called GIGO, G-I-G-O. That means garbage in, garbage out. That means if your starting material is not good, then you will not get good output. But unfortunately, in case of forensics, we cannot control what type of samples that you would get. So ideally, what we would like from an extraction system or extraction kit would be that you can have a universal sample input. That means you can handle many types of samples. It should be effective in removing inhibitors. It should give you maximum yield and quality of DNA. It should be reliable and reproducible. DNA concentration can be concentrated in a minimal volume. Then you should have options of whether performing a manual extraction or an automated protocol under ideal conditions, and it should be cost effective. So we offer the press filer chemistry that has been now in the field for long. So it does not require any organic extraction, silica based purification, ion exchangers, or direct precipitation. What it is done, it is a magnetic bead based technology, which has unique structured magnetic particles and a multi-component surface chemistry, which in tandem will give you efficient DNA binding capacity with maximum recovery. The advantages of using this magnetic bead technology is that it has excellent binding capacity and maximum DNA recovery. It is stable. It has stable binding during wash step while removing PCR inhibitors, and it gives consistent yields of DNA which are separated from the magnetic particles at the elution step. So the difference between a magnetic bead based press filer chemistry versus other chemistry is that it has a very small size particles, which allow you to have more efficient distribution to maximize the surface area with the polymer embedded particles, reagents, and DNA. So that will help achieve you get better yield. So this chart gives you an example of comparison of press filer kit versus different types of chemistry, such as organic extraction, silica bead, or silica membrane, and you will see that press filer kits give you very good quality as compared to others. And here there are different type of sample types that have been tested, such as blood on SPA, blood on cotton, stain, and so forth. So next step would be, usually first step is people, if you have low samples, they will start with manual extraction, but then you would reach the stage where you require an automation system. So why automate sample extraction? So there can be three types of processes where, depending on your needs, like you can use manual extraction prep filer kit if your sample number is less, or manual prep filer BTA kit where your samples are less. When your sample size starts increasing, you can use automated express for a medium throughput lab, or if you have a high throughput lab where you want to process 96 samples at a time, then you have the ID Nimbus. So when you are extracting 96 samples, you have the options of, let us say, you use multiple systems simultaneously to do 96 samples, or where you might require around 2 to 3 hours to process the whole thing, or you can use a system such as ID Nimbus Presto, which is the latest offering, where you can run 96 samples in one go, and in around approximately 45 minutes you would get the DNA. So now if you do the comparison between the both, you would see that when you have a high throughput lab, ID Nimbus Presto will definitely help you save a lot of time. So for automation, the advantages of automation are, first, obviously less hands-on time, because since most of the processes would be like use and plug and play and or use and go, so it minimizes hands-on time. It decreases human touch points, so minimizing potential human errors or contamination risk. And forensics, more importantly, forensic scientists can focus on more complex work. Secondly, it has high reproducibility. So there is less variation between each between runs and for each sample, and you have an increased process standardization, and you always get consistent, reliable results. Because in manual extraction, a person might get tired, whereas in an automated system, since it is robotic, it will do the same work with the same accuracy over and over again. And finally, ease of use, because you can process more samples with less hands-on time, and it is a simplified setup where it's more like walk-away workflow. Like you put the reagents in, and you start the process, and then you can just walk away to do other work. So Automate Express, along with PrepFiler Express and PrepFiler Express DTA kit, is a solution which will help you to get high-quality genomic DNA from forensic samples. So processing, you can process up to 13 samples in approximately 30 minutes. There are two protocols depending on the type of samples that you're using on a single strip. The purified DNA is intact, free of inhibitors, and validated, more importantly, validated for use with quantifier and SDR kits. You also have the option of a variable elution volume. So we offer, like, there are seven options of choosing how much elution volume would be there. That greatly helps you depending on what sample type you are using. So for example, for most of the samples, you would do the lysis using the PrepFiler lysis buffer. And for challenging samples such as bone, tooth, sticky tape, etc., you would use PrepFiler GTA lysis buffer. Once the lysis is done, you load the samples onto the PrepFiler Automate Express instrument, where the DNA binding, the washing, and the elution happens within the system. And then you can choose the elution protocols depending on, like, if you have samples where you expect low amounts of DNA, you can choose low quantities such as 20-30 microliters, or from, like, samples such as blood where you expect high quantity of DNA, you choose higher volumes such as maybe 100 or 200. So you have the greatest range of elution volumes, which will help you optimize your optimal DNA recovery from different sample types. The next one, for higher throughput lab, where you want to process up to 96 samples, you have a fully automated assay-ready workstation. So that is the ID Nimbus Presto. So this system, along with the PrepFiler automated chemistry and your consumables, you can perform up to 96 samples. It is an easy-to-use plug-and-play approach. It is very fast. It has the flexibility of running up to from one sample to 96 samples from a range of sample types, and it has excellent performance and reproducibility. And PrepFiler kit has been validated using ID Nimbus Presto. So in this example, you can see there is a 16-year-old bone which was extracted from a complex circuit and amplified using Identifiler and Identifiler Plus. So no SPR was produced. Then the same sample was extracted with PrepFiler GTA kit and analyzed using Identifiler kit. You can see that you are able to look at the profile that has been generated. Whereas, again, the same sample extracted with the PrepFiler GTA and now with running with Identifiler Plus, you can see there are more number of alleles that are being called. So if you can say Identifiler Plus are the first generation sort of kit, you can say then came the second generation kit. So as technology improves, you have met more better buffer, which will have more stability. They will allow you to load larger sample volumes, such as Global Filer kit, where you can upload up to 15 microliters of the sample. Plus it has more tolerance to inhibitors. And so overall, as you can see, as you go to the latest generation of kits, you will get, you are able to generate more and more profiles. And the take-home message is that PrepFiler GTA would give you more chances of success when you're working with challenging samples such as bone. The second case is where basically they during a victims of a Spanish Civil War, where 24 bodies were deposited in a well in 1937. So using PrepFiler GTA extraction kit in combination with NGM PCR amplification kit, they were able to improve the quantity and quality of the results. Again, this is a work done by a different lab. Below at the bottom, you can see the source. So if interested, you can go and find that in the reference paper. Once you have extracted a DNA, the next step would be quantitation. In quantitation, basically, Quant Studio 5 is the latest system that is used for human identification. So it has been, like you can say, revamped completely. There are a lot of features that are there, which I will try to cover in the next few slides. One would be it has an interactive touchscreen. So basically, as compared to the earlier version where you required the software to look at all the cycling conditions and everything, on the touchscreen itself, you can look at this feature. It is a very bright and intuitive software. You can perform calibrations on the system. The main differentiating feature is that here the calibrations are performed on the instrument and they are stored on the instrument as compared to earlier systems. So in earlier systems, if the system crashed, then you might lose the calibration data, whereas here it is stored on the instrument. So as I said earlier, you can view the cycling conditions. You can view the amplification plots within on the system itself as and when they are going, and then you can choose depending on how do you want to view the data. What you do is, basically the chemistry here is that you have bright white LED which will excite and pass through OptiFlex filters, and the light will fall onto your reaction plate where the fluorescent dyes, if they are getting amplified, will emit signal which is captured by the camera. So the light source is white LED. Since it is a white LED, it has low heat emission, use of low energy, and a longer lifespan. Means you can say approximately 5 years, you don't have to worry about changing the bulb. And the camera is CMOS camera with a more efficient shutter, and overall this instrument consumes less power. Next, along with the instrument, you have the software, the HID real-time feature analysis software version 1.3. It has been designed to be more user-friendly. So this software can be used for both systems, that is the Pond Studio 5 system as well as your 7500 system. So in the system, all the information, the assays, the targets are pre-populated. You have to just type the experiment name and then you perform the run. So the main advantage of using this newer software is that it has an option of using a virtual standard curve. As you all know, when you perform a quantification, you have to run standards each and every time. So what it happens is that making standards, there is a chance of human error, plus running standards increases cost per sample that is there, plus it will increase the time. Whereas in this feature, using the virtual standard curve, you have to enter the values of the target, the slope and the y-intercept for different kits, such as quantifier dry or H2 kit, or can be Q or human kit. And then once you input this standard, then when you perform the run, you do not require to run the standard next time. So for each lot of the kit, you would run the standard, or every week you run the standard once. But then you can use those standard curve values to analyze the data. So that will save you the number of reactions, time, and cost. Then you can create multiple virtual standard curves and choose the appropriate one. And you can also set expiration date so that after that you are not able to use that standard curve. So to make, in short, to recap, for Pond Studio 5 HID real-time system, you have a touchscreen interface, requires low maintenance, calibration is every 2 years, it has an LED lamp with a lifespan of 5 years, it has fixed dye capability. This instrument has been validated to use a quantifier Trio, HP, Duo and human kit. The instrument is smaller in size, so it requires less lab space, and it has a 10 GB onboard memory. That means whatever runs you are performing, it stores in a system. Moreover, the HID real-time software helps you to create plate records, export those records, import results, analyze them. It also has an SPR dilution tool, which will guide you to set up dilution so that you get the use optimal amount in your reactions to get achieve higher first pass success. Also, it has a virtual standard curve which will help you reduce the cost. Moreover, most importantly, this software is compatible with both Pond Studio 5 as well as 7500 system. To complement this instrument, we also offer Quantifiler Trio and HP kit. So these will give you more accurate results in less time for your challenging samples. So it has a
Yes, sir, it is visible now.
Okay. So as I was saying, basically you have greater correlation with downstream results. That means if you see any amplification in the Trio kit, you are going to just say get the results in your SPR kit. Then it also helps you evaluate sample quality, degradation, inhibition in a single reaction. Plus it has basically IPC helps you correlate whether the dropouts that you are getting in an SPR are those actually because of degradation or inhibition, and then you can get accurate negative results and quality indexes so that you it helps you to decide how to process the samples in downstream applications. This kit has been awarded in 2014 as a Reader's Choice Award in Forensic Magazine. So basically, there are four targets that are used in the quantifier trio kit. First one is the small autosomal target of 80 base pair. This is used to quantify the human DNA. Then you have Y chromosomal target, which allows you to quantify the male DNA. Then you have large autosomal target. So the ratio of small to large autosomal target will help you identify whether degradation is happening or not. IPC is a internal, you can say, PCR control, will help you find out whether inhibition is happening or not. And then Mustang Purple is a passive reference test. So in this example, like there was a recently a sexual work, assault workshop conducted where there was a mock sample. In this case, you would see that when you run an STR profile, you can see that in the male-female ratio, it is giving male is one part and approximately 1,000 parts is the female DNA. And then the male part has very low quantity. You see that it is around some 5 picograms. So when you run that sample onto an using Global Filer kit, you got the expected result. That is, you only got a female profile. In the second example, there you can see it is showing the mean degradation index. So the software calculates the mean degradation index based on the ratio of large autosomal, small autosomal to large autosomal. Here it was indicating that there is around 2000 values of mean degradation. That means the samples would be highly degraded. So in this case, with Y-Filer Plus, you still 10 out of 27 alleles were recovered. But then it already gave you an idea that you are not going to get a full profile. So the Scientific Police Service from Rome had performed a degradation study in which the correlation of degradation index and percent of markers was called. They used the Global Filer kit, 1 nanogram DNA input, and as expected, the lesser the DNA in degradation index, the more chances of you getting a complete profile. Like where you have a degradation index of you can say 1 or 1.4 or 1.5, you would expect a full profile, whereas if you have higher degradation index, then you would start getting partial profile. So the Global Quantifier Trio Kit helps you to decide how you go about. Like you have extracted a DNA, you quantify using a trio kit, then based on the values that you get, you would decide whether the DNA is of low concentration, whether it is degraded, whether it is inhibited, is there a mixture of male to female, and if yes, how much. And based on that, then you can decide the optimal processing pathway. Like if you have good DNA, you directly go for autosomal. If you have higher male-female ratio and less male ratio, then you might go for YSTR profiling. If you have very low concentration of DNA or there is inhibition, you can like either concentrate, dilute, or repurify the sample. If you have low concentration but still amplifiable, then you can increase the DNA input. And if you see that there is a chance of higher degradation, you can select STR kits along with any STR kit to try to generate full profile. And if you do not see any amplifiable DNA, you can stop there itself for that particular sample because there would be no DNA available. And once you have taken the choice, you would run them on the STR and generate the profile. Next one added feature is that the most another challenging issue that is faced in forensic labs would be the sexual assault cases. In a traditional workflow, first you would screen for the presence of sperm, then you go for a differential extraction, then you quantify, find out how much DNA is there, whether it is degraded, inhibited, what is the ratio. Based on that, you would run appropriate STR chemistry and then perform the data analysis to find whether DNA profile is present in the particular sample or not. So a novel widescreen approach was developed using Quantifier Trio Kit that would help you reduce time and increase the success rate. There you directly use the swab, take a small section of the swab and process, like you do a quick extraction in which it is like directly adding reagents to a tube and then taking an aliquot and performing the run. And based on the run, like in this example, you have male to female ratio is there low, whereas degradation index is okay, means it is 1.28. there is slight inhibition that is seen. So male to female ratio, how it is calculated? Quantity of male DNA divided by quantity of male DNA, and the ratio is quantity of human DNA minus quantity of male DNA divided by quantity of male DNA. So here, if you see the male female ratio, a male is one part and 97 parts is female. So in this case, we directly know that you would not get an profile for the male part if you run a direct autosomal kit, and that was the same result that you observed, like no minor male were detected. But then if you then further use this sample for profiling using Y-filer or Y-filer plus, then you would expect a more probative result. So Y-screening can bypass, it can enhance your screening time by bypassing most of the steps. Like by doing Y-screening, if you see there is only male DNA, then only you proceed with those samples for differential extraction and other downstream applications. If it is not present, then you can just stop at that process. So for Y-screen, 5 external test sites participated in the study. They used over 100 samples of different types. They were the non-probative mock casework samples, and they were using standard method as well as the Y-screen assay. The swabs were extracted using organic extraction and commercially available products. So what was found, that 91% of the samples show concordance between Y-screen and SPR genotype results. Whereas success rate of other presumptive tests such as AP and other tests was relatively lower compared to Y-screen. So this is a poster which shows the methodology and how and the results that were obtained using the Y-screen technology. So sexual assault screening, you can basically use the Y-screen protocol because it will assist in reducing backlog samples, streamline samples for differential extraction, and provide confidence about how to process the samples. You can also find more information on our website where customers have talked about these processes on the customer video. So once you have extracted the DNA, quantified it, then you proceed with the amplification. So in our kit, we have introduced a new system which is called the Internal Quality Control, or IQC. So what is IQC? So IQC consists of two synthetic sequences termed as small and large. As you can see in this image on the right side, marked with yellow square. So on the left is the IQC small, on the right is the IQC large. So primers are specific for each of the targets and are included in the primer set. The IQC markers will co-amplify to provide positive confirmation whether the assay is working as per expectation, and it can be used to confirm the validity of negative results and or identify samples containing PCR inhibitors. So like in these two examples, in one case, on the top side, top image, you can see that the IQC small is amplifying, whereas the IQC large is not amplifying, and you get a steep slope. Whereas in the bottom image, you can see IQC is well amplified and balanced for small as well as large, but here also you observe a steep slope. In normal scenario, if you observe the speed slope, you would have to figure out whether this slope is due to inhibition or degradation. Whereas, because the IQC small and large are designed under synthetic template, ideally they should amplify and have a balanced profile. So, if there is an imbalance in the IQC small and large, that would indicate inhibition. Whereas, if both have a balanced profile, then that would indicate that sample might have degradation. And based on this, you can decide how to proceed further. So Global Filer IQC kit and Verifiler Plus IQC kit are two kits which have this IQC component within them. So both of the kits have, most of the markers are common. Only differences would be in markers such as Penta-E, Penta-D or SE33. And both kits have higher discrimination power and mini-SPRs. Mini-SPRs are something which would help you in case of degraded samples. So there are around 10 to 11 mini-SPRs that are there. Plus both kits have the advantage of using higher sample volume inputs such as 15 microliters for Global Filer, 17.5 microliters for Verifiler Plus, where you require around 500 picogram of target. So once you have amplified the product, then you go for sequencing. So traditionally, you can say we have been evolving from 1994, where it was a single capillary. Before that, there was 370. That was a gel-based system. Then from one capillary to 4, 8, 16, 96. So the right now, 3500 is the most common workhorse that is used in the forensic lab. And we have recently introduced Six Studio Genetic Analyzer, which is a 4 capillary based system. So the advantage of this is that for labs which are having a low throughput, or which also plan on doing sequencing using mitochondrial DNA, so you can use this system because it uses the same polymer for sequencing as well as fragment analysis. It is a 4 capillary based system, which has automatic optical alignment and automatic spectral calibration. That means it does calibration by itself. It has a smaller footprint as compared to other instruments. The data collection software is within the system and it can be controlled by the touch screen. It has consumables which are RFID tags, such as for 3500, you can use 9612 plate or 8-strip tube format. And other optional features or additional features you require are like GeneMapper IDX version 1.6, that is the latest software, SA module, and Fix Studio Plate Manager. So it has a similar workflow as like what you do for your regular process. You prepare the samples, you prepare the consumables, load them onto the system. Loading of the consumables is very straightforward and simple, and then you perform the run. So the cartridge that is used for the system, it is a next step in technology. So your polymer, pump, syringe, everything is compacted into one single cartridge, which contains the capillary buffer polymer and everything that is required to perform the electroporation. It's a simple 4 capillary system, which requires 4 minute hands-on time. So it reduces time from hours to minutes. Now, once you have generated data, then you require data collection software to analyze the data. So the latest system that has been there is the data collection version 4 and GeneMapper version 1.6. So as things evolve, the requirement from your side will keep on changing. So what we did was we sent a survey to the various labs and asked them what their requirements were. So the reviews or the survey we got back, it was improved data interpretation, so that it will help reduce pull-up edit, improve first-pass success rate for database labs, more efficient transfer to probabilistic genotyping. That was one part. Second part was improved user experience, that means added flexibility for 3500 series instruments, streamlined workflow, supported languages, and a possibility of entire installation standard usage. IT compliance, because now Windows 7, Microsoft has stopped supporting Windows 7. So people wanted to have IT compliance, so it should have Windows 10 support, CODIS compatibility, and internationalization. So our answer to all these questions was the data collection version 4 software and GeneMapper IDX. So first requirement was like improved data interpretation. That is the pull-up, the number of pull-ups that can be reduced so that you require less time for interpretation. So in this example, where you have used 1 nanogram of sample using Global Filer Kit, analyze that 50 RFU, you can see there are 31 pull-ups. That is, there are 31 signals that user has to review and decide whether to accept those or remove those. So with the pull-up reduction algorithm, there are now even lesser pull-ups. So there are just 6 pull-ups that are there. So now you would require less time to analyze the same result. So next question was off-scale recovery for databasing labs. Usually if you use too much DNA, then it can cause off-scale of the sequence, as shown here that the peak gets cut off. This off-scale capture in the off-scale recovery algorithm, it has been improved so that it will decrease manual interpretation, provide truer peak height, and the signal has been raised. The saturation levels have been raised from 32,000 RFU to 65,000 RFU, so that the global feed filters become more effective, stutter filters are more applicable, and there is a decreased pull-up associated with off-scale peaks. The on-scale data, such as the one shown with the green peak, this will not get impacted. So you have higher first-pass success rate, so this can be achieved, like the database kit says that identifier direct, yfiler, global filer, express, verifiler, express, yfiler plus, and the casework kit says that global filer. This can take the advantage of this off-scale data recovery algorithm. So in this example, it is showing on the top, you can see when there is a 3500 saturation limit and no off-scale reduction algorithm, like you get multiple samples that are flagged because of off-scale, whereas the same data, if you analyze this off-scale recovery, like the same samples are re-injected and analyzed, then you would observe that the saturation limit has increased to 65,000, and then these samples will pass the off-scale flag. So that will help you increase your throughput because you have less data to interpret. So these features help you save time. You can run the samples for screening. So pull-up reduction algorithm or scale reduction algorithm for databases can help you save time. Like earlier, if you had to have a pull, let us say for example 15 to 20 pull-ups, using the earlier data collection software and the GreenMapper IDX software, you would require 10 to 15 minutes. Whereas with the newer software, the pull-ups would be drastically reduced. This is an example to illustrate. Maybe 5 to 6, this would be there. So the review time would now reduce from 15 minutes to, we can say, 3 minutes. So overall, now if this is for, like, we can say, one sample, now you start thinking in multiple samples, that will help you to drastically save time. In data analysis, again, review of off-scale data and review of pull-ups would be reduced. And then there are, in exporting data, there are new features that are added for exporting and sorting. So overall, it will increase your first pass success, and Windows 10 compatibility would help you, because if Windows 10, so Microsoft is removing the support for 7 operating system, so there can be security concerns which can be avoided if you upgrade to this newer system. Secondly, in terms of flexibility for 3500 system, earlier you would create a plate, load plate, start a run. So you wanted flexibility. What we have done is that now with the newer so data collection software, you can start a run and then you can pause a run in between to create new plate, remove a completed plate and add a new plate, and then restart the run, modifying the prior injection list, and so that by the end of the day, when one more plate is over, you can again add one more plate and restart the run. So then you can increase your throughput. So overall, basically, what the whole process will help you is to increase accuracy, so you get more informative and comprehensive casework sample assessment because of the improved data. Then efficiency, because your efficiency would increase with faster time to results and flexibility for sample processing protocols. And finally is the flexibility, which allows you to have a configurable output and display features. So like if you start using the latest technology, it will help you reduce the time required to analyze one sample, and that's how you can try reducing the tendency. So with that, I complete my talk and I'm open for questions. Thank you.
Thank you so much, sir. So there are certain questions in the chat box. So the question is, if the clothing is burnt, then is it possible to extract DNA?
It depends on, it might be possible, because I have heard of a case where a colleague of mine has worked on charred bone, but then you have to increase the number of sample input volume to ensure or enhance your chances of success. So actually it all depends on how the cloth is burned and where the DNA is lying.
Hello. Yes, sir. So there is one more question. So in these burned cases, which extraction method of DNA is suitable for sample extraction?
Let us say partially burned bone, you can try the profiler BTA process. But if it is a completely charred bone, then you might have to use larger volumes of your starting sample. In that case, then organic profiler BTA protocol might be helpful.
Okay, thank you, sir. There are a few more questions. So yeah. Is the optical and background calibration of Quant Studio same as the ABI 7550?
Yes. So the calibration, see, the technology remains the same in terms of calibration. So the optical calibration, you can say, So optical calibration you do for the ROI, region of interest, then you perform background, then you do the dye calibration, that for 7500 or Constigify remains the same. The only difference is that the calibration files for 7500 are stored in the computer or the desktop or the laptop, whereas for Constigify, those are stored into your internal system itself. So the advantage is that if your system for some reason crashes, in 7500 you might have to do the recalibration, whereas in Constudio 5, because it is stored into the system, you will not lose that data. Secondly, for 7500, ideally it is 6 months to 1 year you have to do the calibration, whereas for Constudio 5, it is every 2 years.
Okay, sir. Sir, also, how does bone marrow transplantation affect DNA testing?
So if you do a bone marrow transplant, slowly over time, if you take the blood sample, the recipient profile will start decreasing, and in between phases, like initially when there would be a mixture like profile, and then slowly as time progresses and the donor hematopoietic stem cells take over the blood production, then in that case the WBC production and everything, slowly the recipient profile will disappear, and only, or you might get a very baseline recipient profile, whereas you will get a complete profile of the donor. But then if you take a buccal swab of any other tissue, then you should get the profile of the recipient.
Okay, sir. Sir, can you please discuss some case stories of DNA fingerprinting in the Indian criminal justice system?
In terms of like, I'll take a few. Because of confidentiality clause, actually I cannot discuss such things. But I can give you an example. In one case where a skull was obtained to generate profile, and they tried all molar, all tooth, like all teeth were utilized for extraction, but they were not able to get any profile. But there is a region called the petrous region, which is in the temporal lobe behind our ear. So basically that has a high bone density. So we extracted the bone from that region, and then using Trefiler BT and Automate Express, we were able to generate a full profile. So it all depends on what choice of sample you are starting, which extraction chemistry you are using. And like with Global Filers, you have the advantage of using 15 microliters. And by quantitating, you already know whether the DNA is present or not. So if you follow the process correctly, it helps you increase the first pass success. So where they had tried multiple things which had failed, the petrous region had helped generate a profile.
Thank you so much, sir. Sir, also, in case of bone marrow transplant, how can DNA profiling or fingerprinting can be established if the person is suspect?
So it is better if you suspect it's a bone marrow transplant, then you take the buccal swab and use them to generate the profile for the as a reference.
Okay, thank you so much, sir. Sir, one more question. So, what are the common inhibitors tested in the internal quality control system?
So, basically, internal quality, the IQC, it will like humic acid and common inhibitors are already tested for the system. But keep in mind, so any inhibitor that affects your amplification, that means it affects the DNA polymerase from synthesizing molecules, that would affect the IQC, because IQC, what is done is that you add synthetic DNA of known quantity into your mix. If that is already mixed, user doesn't have to mix some synthetic DNA that is already included in the kit. So when you try to amplify, so if there is inhibition, irrespective of whatever is the inhibitor, if it inhibits DNA polymerase activity, in that case the IQC will also get affected. As you know, when inhibition happens, smaller molecules will be less affected, smaller size molecules will be less affected as compared to higher size molecules. So you start seeing a difference between the IQC small signal versus IQC large signal. So take home message is, inhibitors, so IQC will detect any inhibitors which affect amplification.
Okay, thank you so much, sir. So one more question. So whenever we go ahead for DNA examination, we use many high radiations as well as high intensity light sources. So does that make any changes in the nucleotide sequence, and does that also cause any mutation?
If when you are looking at examining the samples, like if you are using UV or high ionizing radiation, which can degrade the DNA, or so that will affect the quality of the DNA. And then, but you have to keep in mind, cross-linking can happen, but then because there is no repair mechanism within the dead cells, okay, so if cells are dead, and so there will be no repair mechanism which will be there, so chances of mutations are very, very less. But then there can be some chemical reactions which might cause changes in the, you can say, the nucleotides, such that during amplification, you might have a mutation, but those frequencies would be very, very, very low. But chances of degradation would be higher.
Okay. So I must say the presentation was so informative that we have many questions here. So I would like to take a few more questions with your permission.
Yeah, sure.
So which kit is ideal for extracting DNA from skeleton exhumed from a biogas plant?
So if the bones are there, I would say Pressfiler GT is the best choice to go with. And automated extraction, so that you have lesser chance. Then, because biogas, when you say, it depends on which type of biogas is there. But I would suggest that better would be to take from the inner side of the bone. And for a bone to get a success, higher success, you have to ensure to choose a bone which is the most intact and where you have higher density of bone. The more dense the bone is, the greater the chances of getting DNA from that type.
Okay, sir. Sir, so how often spikes come in, let us CE instrument, let us capillary electrophoresis instrument?
So spikes are generated because of variety of reasons. So you say, for example, spikes can be generated because you are using bad quality high dye, you are not changing the buffer frequently, there is dirt in the room, so dirt is the most common cause for spikes. Second, voltage fluctuations are there, then you are not maintaining the instrument are there. So there are a variety of variables that are present. But I would say the most common thing would be dirt. So it depends on how clean the lab is and how regularly they're maintaining the reagents and equipment. That will help resolve the spike issue.
Okay, sir. So last question. Can you please give some examples that in which case we go for YSTR profiling?
So you take an example like there is a sexual assault has happened, and in that case, what has happened is that you get a stain on cloth, or you have taken some swabs which are there. So when you perform a quant, and then let us say if it shows you a male to female ratio greater than 1:10 or 1:20, then you know that if you go for autosomal STR profiling, because the male fraction is more than the female, in that case, then it would only give you autosomal profile of the female and not of the male. But whereas if you use the same DNA and amplify using YSTR, you would be able to identify that. Second case where you can use YSTR profiling, when you are trying to look for the paternal lineage.
Thank you, sir. So with that, now I request Dr. Shaji Prabha to give the concluding remarks.
Hello.
Yes, sir.
Yes. And now I will invite Dr. Abel Joseph to say a few words about this session. He is working in this field. Sir Abel, sir, please unmute.
Hi. Good morning, sir. Thank you.
Right, sir.
Dr. Amit, good morning.
Good morning, sir.
It was very good presentation. We know each other. We met in Japan also last time. And
yeah, HID.
I mean, just my one of my question is that, have you done any validation studies among Indian population for global filer kit?
Not for only Indian population, but then they have taken representative sample for global filer. But to my knowledge, I don't think as of now, I do not know whether they have used Indian samples per se. But then I can always get back to you by finding.
Generally, it is saying Asian population. As you know, that Indian population is varied, having different gene pools, and there are chances of mutations out there. So that's why I asked. Okay. So is any universities or any institutions run any validation studies?
So that way there will be papers. So maybe, sir, I'll get back to you with more information on this, because I cannot remember on top of my mind. Because there have been validation studies using global filer kits that have been performed. But whether it is Indian, I cannot recollect immediately. But then if not, I can always pass this suggestion to our R&D team, because based on your interest and requirements, we try to evolve the kit.
All right. Okay. Generally, you are in the Indian subcontinent and you are traveling across the India. And in case studies, generally, are they using ID Plus kit or for crime scene samples or global filer?
So it's a mixed bag. Some regions are using global filer kit. Some regions are using identifier kit. It all depends on how comfortable the people are, how well versed those people are. So it's, I would say, a mixed bag of both.
Okay. Another question is that in the interpretation part, you know, the what is the minimum and maximum threshold in Indian scenario? Like, you know, for example, 50 RFU is the lowest for the crime samples, and 150 is for the homozygous. So is there any standard like that in Indian interpretation standard?
So ideally what has to be done is each lab has to decide its analytical and stochastic threshold. So what we recommend is don't try to usually go below 50 RFU for global filer 3500, because the threshold also depend on the instrument, but usually below 50 we do not recommend, because you start seeing noise in that area. So what people usually would have to do is run dilution series, and then same sample with known profile, then you have to run and ensure that at which threshold for your instrument you are getting a single peak instead of a heterozygous condition, then that would be the cutoff for your higher threshold. Whereas where you start seeing your actual signal as compared to noise by running negative samples, you can generate the lower baseline threshold. So yeah, some instruments might have a lower sensitivity, you can say, so their threshold might be slightly lower or higher. So it is actually the thresholds are based on instrument to instrument and the lab conditions. 50 usually is the common they would use, and people go up to 250 where you have good
3500 for example, sir, 3500 for example, it is going below 50. How can we say that the peaks are, you know, it's a contaminated profile, you know? What guarantee that we can assure to the court that, you know, because there should be some standards, right?
So we have what we call the HPS or the HID professional services that we offer. So there we take such exercises where we visit the lab, perform the validation, and then we will tell for your instrument, these are the basic lower level cutoff. Anything below that, you should not consider as a signal, because it has a higher chance of being a noise. So, but then for that, you have to do those validation studies.
Yeah, and you were in your presentation, it was mentioning that you are the latest CE instrument which is removing the pull-ups. So in general practice, which I have been practicing actually, we actually have the right, the expert has the right to remove the pull-ups or any other artifacts like strutters, spikes. The software and removing like that, you know, depends, as you just mentioned, it depends upon the instrument to instrument, you know. Instrument is removing, I don't think it is advisable, you know.
So sir, it will not remove stutter, it will remove pull. So basically what the software will do is it will look for the allelic marker and their location, and then it will look for the pull-up. So there is some algorithm which will only reduce pull-up which are associated because of your signal, not because of a stutter. So stutters and all, otherwise the pull-up would have been become zero. If you see in the second image where we had seen, there were only 6 pull-ups. Okay, so there are certain set of algorithms which will dictate, which is noise related to instrumental pull-up. Instrument or spectral pull-up, it will try to reduce that and not other artifacts.
All right, okay. So,
And one more thing, this data collection feature is not just for the latest instrument, but it is also, if you have 3500, if you upgrade your 3500 with data collection 4 and GeneMapper ID8 version 1.6, you can use this feature.
Yeah. Regarding the Converse software, is any labs they are using in India the Converse software?
Yes, there is one lab which is using the Converse software for NGS application. That is there. So if anybody is interested in knowing Converse application, we can have a webinar on that also if required, so that you understand what this software is capable of doing.
Okay, and in real-time quantitation, you have mentioned about the degradation index, and you know.
Yeah.
So how TRIO is compared to TRIO to DIO? So how TRIO is better in that case? Only in the degradation that particular point only, or any other features?
So the other features for TRIO are the assay has been designed for multi-copy targets. That means. The assay is designed instead of a single target RNSP or SRY gene. Here it is a multi-copy target, so the chances of detecting even low copies, like it can detect 1.5 cells in a reaction, so it has a very high sensitivity. Secondly, the number of standards that are required to perform the test, you require only 5 standards in duplicate, whereas in the earlier scenario you had to create 8 standards for DO. So it also reduces number of standards, plus runtime is around, it has been reduced, like from 90 minutes to maybe around 1 hour or so. So you save on time as well.
Okay, in the extraction part, in the differential extraction, that is still, it is manual differential. So you have any other options,
we have a prep filer differential extraction protocol. So if anybody are interested, I can share you that the process. Part of the differential process remains the same, but then the extraction can then be transferred on the automatic express.
Doctor, I mean, it is manual, right? The manual part, we have to do that manual part.
Yes. So initial lysis and separation of the sperm fraction and epithelial fraction has to be manual. But here the process is simplified by using some buffers, and then those two aliquots you can directly add to your automatic express. So once lysis has been done for the two, still differentially separating epithelial and sperm, that is manual. After that, automated express can take care of the rest.
In for example, to optimizing the PCR quantity, so for example, we do not have enough quantity suspected after the quantitation, we know that. So reconcentration, normally in which tool you are using, normally Microcon or Amicon, which one you suggest? Which is better
So I would say, first of all, because both are not our products, I cannot favor one over the other. But if I'm not mistaken, I think so one of them has stopped producing the cutoff filter. So only one is remaining. I am not able to recollect which one.
Do you have anything in particular?
No, I have tried Amicon column once or twice. I have not used much. So I would not honestly say, but then in those cases it had worked.
I have used both. I have used for both for many years. But Microcon, I suggest it is better. But the small size of it, which is very difficult to handle. That's the only challenge.
Yes. So that is the tricky part.
Yeah. Anyhow, it was really very good information, and I would like to share your contact. I think I have already. Dr. Shiva Prasad, and we actually need you to be there in our Kerala. I know it's an Indian scenario. You know that you are always in the north part, so to get a little more training and technical support to our lab systems in Kerala. Thank you very much.
Sure, sir. I'll do that. Thank you, sir. And thank you all for providing me this opportunity to present. And thank you for your time.
Thank you, Abhi sir, for your valuable suggestion.
Okay, thank you, sir.
Hello. Thank you, Abhi sir, for your valuable suggestion.
Thank you.
Sir, Arvind sir, any comment from your side, sir? Arvind sir?
Arvind sir is not there, sir. Arvind sir have left the program.
Okay.
We can go to
Please, Annamma madam. Is any comment?
Dr. Amit, it was a very nice presentation, and we got very much informative talk from you. And the question asked whether it is possible to extract DNA from a skeleton exhumed from a biogas plant. That question is generally based on one case study in one unsolved case in Kerala scenario. That okay. skeleton. That a body fell in the biogas. Biogas plant means a cow dung pit. Only after skeletonizing, it could be recovered from there. And police says that they send the skeleton for DNA extraction. And the opinion they received was nothing is possible to do with this skeleton. That was the reply they obtained. So okay. according to academic interest, I asked whether it is possible to extract DNA or how will this cow dung affect the DNA material? Is there any reaction in that way?
So cow dung studies have not been done, but what I can tell you, in biogas, there are bacteria that are present to generate the methane gas. So chances are, if there are other bacteria and fungi which are present within that, they might enter the bone pores and might degrade the DNA in the slurry, but then you can always try. So I would suggest, I always say, whatever sample you have, at least you can give it a shot. Try at least once, because sometimes what happens, depending on how the body was positioned, and so it might be possible, like the femur bone or some bones which are intact and they have not yet been digested by the bacteria. So if you go for the inner region, you might get a partial profile, maybe 6 alleles, less alleles, but at least you will get something. So there could be a chance. I would not say completely zero, but till we try, it would be very hard to say for sure.
Dr. Amit, what about SNB, NGS, there is a possibility?
NGS, you would have a higher possibility because the amplicon sizes are smaller. So even maybe 100 variants. So in NGS, definitely it might improve the chances, assuming again that the DNA is not degraded completely.
Okay, thank you very much.
Okay. Thank you, ma'am. Before conclusion, thank you, Dr. Amit Gokhale, for the wonderful session. Before we end, let me just conclude that the entire forensic science community in the country start changing with the innovation that you have mentioned. This session will be very much beneficial in the field of forensic science, especially DNA profiling, which is useful for in crime investigation. I thank all the dignitaries for your active participation and for being a part of the webinar series by Indian Criminology.